Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Holy Marriage Blessing, the radio ministry of the Unification Families of Kingston. And I'm your host, Tyler Hendricks, here with our co-host, Pastor Ruth Mwanda, welcoming you to a new week and to our Holy Marriage Blessing radio ministry that is dedicated to marriage. It's dedicated to the ideal of man and woman coming together as one, receiving the love of God, the mysterious, magical, mystical, spiritual, physical love that is ours to receive from God, and to bring forth children into this world in the image of God. We're dedicated to that. Our topic this week is Marriage Makes God Visible. I have a good friend, Jerry Servito. He's a teacher of our unification thought. And he told me, God never wanted to be invisible. And I could truly resonate with that. Who wants to be invisible? If you had to ask someone, would you rather be visible or invisible? If you really think about it, we'd much rather be visible. We'd much rather be able to relate to people. If you're invisible, no one can see you. No one can feel you. No one can touch you. No one can talk to you. You can't feel anything from anybody. God is in that kind of situation. Our founders, True Father, Sun Myung Moon, True Mother, Hak Ja Han Moon, blessed in marriage, progenitors of the Holy Marriage Blessing, our True Father said that in the spiritual world, God is light. God is like a diamond emitting an infinite stream of beautiful light. And yet that is not really what God wants to be. God wants to be our parents. Jesus said, if you see me, you see the Father. God was so happy when Jesus could say that. He could say, now you are my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. And God could see and feel and touch the world, and the world could see and feel and touch God through Jesus. Tragically, what God experienced, what Jesus experienced, was not the most pleasant experience. It was a lot of hatred, persecution, anger, terrible things that led Jesus to be nailed on the cross and to shed his blood. But that was not God's ideal. It was that Jesus could experience love, the love of his brothers and sisters, the love of his parents, the love of ultimately his wife, one special woman. And that woman, united with Jesus, could with him stand up and say, if you see me, you see God. If you see us, you see God. And if you see our children, you see God. Marriage, true marriage, makes God visible. So we're going to talk about that today. And we pray that you will join with us in meditation and consideration, and that the outcome will be getting a little closer to God and getting a little closer to your husband, to your wife, to your parents, to your children. To bring us to that point, I'd like to ask and invite Pastor Ruth to offer our opening prayer. Pastor Ruth.
Let us pray. Our dear most and beloved loving heavenly parent, true parents of heaven and earth and humankind, and our beloved Lord Jesus, we come before you deeply humbled in our hearts and with hearts full of gratitude and thanksgiving unto you for giving us this new day and for giving us this time to come before you to worship, to praise, and also to glorify your name. Heavenly Father, for especially the gift of life. Thanking you also for the good health, and Father, for the countless blessings that you shower unto us day by day. Father, we cannot even fathom the amazing blessings that you've given to us all throughout our lives. And therefore, Father, we can only be grateful and pray that as we forge forward, that we can be able to keep our faith in you, that we can be able to keep our trust in you and renew our determination to grow our hearts day by day closer to you, that we can become one with you. This was your desire from the beginning. You wanted, Father, to live with your children, and you wanted your children to be obedient and to live with you. And that, Father, you could be able to resonate with us and with us with you, heart to heart. But Father, because of the fall, you have lived a lonely life, seeking for ways and means to reconnect us, Father, back with you. And today, through our true parents, you are teaching us how we can be able to be reconnected, and even how we can be able to make you visible by perfecting marriage, after receiving the grace of the forgiveness of the original sin that was acquired by the fall. And this is through our true parents, whom you have sent today as the Lord of the Second Advent, on the foundation of our Lord Jesus, who came and appointed to attain this very mission, Heavenly Father. But because he was nailed on the cross, your providence was only prolonged. But Father, ultimately today, your will have been brought into fulfillment through our true parents. And they are sharing this blessing, Heavenly Father, with the whole of mankind. All we need is to accept it. And therefore, Father, we are grateful to you. We are grateful to all your sacrifice and work that you have done to bring us to this understanding and to this level, Heavenly Father. Let glory and honor be to you. And let us receive this blessing, Father, deeply humbled. And that, Father, we can be able to expand and grow your kingdom here on earth. This was your desire, and it is your desire today. And therefore we pray that, Father, for those who listen to these words, they can find ways, Heavenly Father, to receive this blessing, for it is given free. But Heavenly Father, this is only the beginning of a world of peace, of families of peace, communities of peace that give you joy and happiness. Therefore, Father, we want to invite your presence and your guidance as we share your words. I pray this humbly in the name of the Lord. Amen.
Thank you for your prayer, Pastor Ruth. Now, we are talking about the visible God. And you heard from Pastor Ruth how what God has done through our true parents, true father, Sun Myung Moon, true mother, Hak Jahan Moon, called by Jesus, led by the Holy Spirit, Bible-based, that they are immersed in God's love, not because they were lifted out into some cloud or mountaintop, but because they love people, they serve people, they sacrifice for people, and they everything in the name of God. So true marriage is something they accomplished for us, and it makes God visible. Now, often I refer to the findings of social science, the social sciences in the arena of marriage studies, family studies, and how so uniformly these studies reveal that marriage is a dividing line between better and worse, between health and illness, between happiness and unhappiness, between prosperity and poverty. Marriage is a universal dividing line. And whether we cross that line and become married and give our lives to our marriage and believe in it and give our lives to our spouse and to our children and thereby make our parents, of course, so happy, that's up to us. It's our responsibility. And most people, many people, let's say, find that decision easy to make because they have a certain religious or spiritual foundation. But there's another foundation besides religion and spirituality, and that is science, social science. So I'm going to share some new research. And this is from a journal called The Natural Family, an international journal of research and policy, which is published by the International Organization for the Family, which comes out of Rockford, Illinois. And this is a journal and an organization I recommend very, very highly. So just some of the studies. The first study here, America's New Caste System, the Wedlock Divide. Progressives endlessly lament the way a growing gap in economic well-being divides Americans. Curiously, these progressives say remarkably little about the changes in family life that are fast making that gap permanent. The basic gist of the research, which was done by the University of California in Santa Barbara and the University of Washington, is that those who marry are almost inevitably more prosperous, more wealthy than those who do not get married. And there's many, many reasons for that. But poverty rates are substantially higher for unmarried women with children at all levels of education compared to married women with children. And poverty rates run the same also for men. So this is a finding. And here's another something they discovered, which is also, or they discovered again, because it's been proven before, but it's proven again. There are those who say cohabitation is just as good as marriage, but they find that parental cohabitation, as opposed to marriage, is strongly associated with adverse outcomes for children and adolescents. And these adverse outcomes continue. These malign effects persist into adulthood, making it hard for children coming from such a family background to succeed in life. Therefore, the lack of marriage is a potential contributor to future inequality. In other words, the income gap is going to get bigger and bigger and bigger because there's more and more divorce, more and more cohabitation, more and more infidelity. So this is the result of this particular study. A second one that was done in England by King's College in London is that women during pregnancy is not an easy time for women. And sometimes women will get a little depressed, and they really need, women need, I'm not a woman, so I say they, and we husbands need to provide support, protection, comfort, care for our wives. And if there's no man like that in their life, married to her, it's a predictor of depression and anxiety. And those who are not married, or who are single, have a partner, you know, a partner who's not living in the same household, will have much more psychological problems during the pregnancy. So marriage, married women, married pregnant women experienced marriage satisfaction that helps so much during the pregnancy, and that unmarried women do not have. Also another study, and this was a study, a global study, done by universities working together all around the world, including Harvard, University of Pennsylvania, University of Washington, Peking University in China, Balamand University in Lebanon, Moi University in Kenya, the University of Otago in New Zealand, etc., Brazil, Australia, Japan, France, Northern Ireland. And this is a finding that they all agree about. They all put it all together. It's the same everywhere in the world, that marriage is a shield against trauma, that unmarried people have much more trauma. For example, accidents, the death of a loved one, being mugged, experiencing a life-threatening illness or injury. What the universities found was that being married was the most consistent protective factor in terms of dealing with or avoiding trauma in one's life. Now, they come up with a lot of reasons for this, and there are very valid reasons. And I want to add, or we want to add, Pastor Ruth and I, the most important internal reason, and that is that marriage makes God visible. True marriage brings God into our lives, and when we have God, when we share God, something supernatural comes into our lives, and science proves it, that protects people from every country in the world, protects us from trauma, makes our lives more peaceful, more safe, more serene, more happy. So Pastor Ruth now is going to share True Father Moon's teachings about why this is. Pastor Ruth.
Thank you so much, Dr. Hendricks. And we're going to turn to our readings. And the topic is to achieve the ideal of oneness of God and humankind in love. And I read, God, the subject partner of true love, has established human beings as his partners of love. God's ideal of love is fulfilled through human beings. God's purpose of creation is to bring about the world of absolute ideal of God and humankind united in love. Human beings were therefore created as the object partners of God's highest and deepest love. Thus, among the creation, they are the only object partners who wear the substantial body of God. They are born as the visible body of God before the invisible God. When human beings reach perfection, they become God's temples. They are the visible substantial beings in whom God can always enter and dwell in freedom and peace. God's overall ideal of absolute true love is realized and perfected through human beings in a vertical relationship between parents and children. Until now, no one has understood where God's love and humankind's love merge. Without knowing this, you cannot call God Father. That word has no relevance to God. Adam and Eve are God's bodies. Thus, when Adam and Eve reach perfection, God's internal nature is manifested in man's mind, and God's external form is manifested in woman's mind. The physical wedding ceremony of Adam and Eve, it's God's wedding ceremony. When you go to the spirit world, you will know it for sure. You will see that these incomprehensible theories are all correct. Hence, only when you occupy God's love is your ambition fully satisfied and will say, now I'm content. When human beings are perfected, they attain divine nature and become perfect as Heavenly Father is perfect, realizing a valuable comparable to God. God is the absolute being, and he cannot realize his ideal of true love by himself. It is because the ideal of love necessarily requires a partner. At this point, we should understand what the relationship between the beginning and the completion of God's true love and humankind love, true love is. What if God, without establishing human beings as absolute object partners of true love, had tried to achieve the beginning and the completion of his love in some other way? The true love ideal of God and human beings would have had different motivations, and the direction and purpose of the two forms of love would have differed. God is the root of love, the root of life, the root of lineage, and the root of the kingdom of heaven on earth and the kingdom of heaven in heaven. When Adam and Eve get married, God enters the hearts of Adam and Eve and realizes oneness in love. God is the vertical true parent. Adam and Eve are the horizontal true parents. Because we were born with the blood and flesh of these two sets of parents, our mind becomes the vertical self and our body becomes the horizontal self. Since the realm of the oneness of God and humankind in love is realized through this, those who complete the oneness of mind and body in love become God's sons and daughters. When they become God's princes and princesses, they can have a child-parent relationship with God and inherit everything. When such children become husband and wives and totally unite based on true love, they become the family that lives with God, and that family becomes a base of peace and the ideal. A man and a woman, each being half, becomes one and comes to complete the ideal love as God's partners. In other words, by perfecting human being as beings of infinite value through true love, God also perfects true love and completes the world of ideal of creation where the eternal ideal love dwells. When we realize the oneness of mind and body and the oneness of husband and wife, we naturally return to God. The foundation of true love is supposed to centering on God. This is the realm of perfection, unification, and oneness. This is the foundation of unification. In this case, God himself also unifies. There is nothing that can separate the oneness of God and humankind in love. There is no force that can tear them apart. God, who wants perfection and completion through true love between the Creator and human beings, needed a condition of oneness with them. That is why God needed a commandment to give the first human ancestor, knowing that they are at the stage of immaturity. While they were growing up through the growing period, God set a condition to bequeath to them the most precious true love. This was the commandment. And may God bless these words.
And you're listening to Holy Marriage Blessing, the ministry of the Unification Families of Kingston. And to go directly to the summary of our readings today, how we can find out how to attain oneness with God. This is attainable when man and woman become the visible body of God, God's object partners, by realizing oneness of mind and body with God and oneness as husband and wife, we naturally return to God. just as Jesus said, "Don't you know that you are God's temple? Be perfect as our Heavenly Father is perfect." When a husband and wife give themselves to God in marriage and in all their lives, this becomes the meeting point. God's love is perfected, our love is perfected, and we come to realize the purpose of creation. And this is where eternal love dwells. This also becomes the foundation for love for our offsprings, and all of us are unified with God. Husband and wife and children are also unified in true love. And this is the beginning of the kingdom of God here on earth in our homes. These are the teachings of our true parents, our true father, the Reverend Sang Yang Moon, and our true mother, Hak Jahan Moon, called by Jesus to complete his work as the Lord of the Second Advent. And may God bless you and your families.
This is Holy Marriage Blessing, Radio Ministry of the Unification Families of Kingston. Our music is by Ronan Hardiman, Oasis, Hillsong, Gandalf Murphy, and David Eaton, and Seiko Lee, and David Doerr. Grateful for your listening. We'll talk to you again next week. And always remember, keep God visible.